We're going to sing one verse of Victory in Jesus. I heard an old story, how his Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning, and I repented of my sin, won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his free.
The Bible says that we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says that we have victory through faith in the Son of God. Thank you for being here today, and may we go to God in prayer. Father, we are so grateful to be in your house today. Thank you for the Word of God that is our strength, our guidance, our comfort. For these people who have gathered today and for those who view this program by way of television, we ask that Jesus Christ be honored in our hearts, that we might love him and serve him. Thank you for the many, many blessings you give us every day. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now shake hands with your neighbor. Give everyone a warm welcome to the house of God. I welcome our television viewers today, Forest Home Baptist Church, on the loop in Kilgore. Be faithful to your church. If you do not have a church home, come and visit with us, please. Well, we have a nice congregation. Remember now that we have 23 or 25 or something like that of our adults with Brother Mark in Branson, Missouri. They're actually on their way home, I think. And I haven't had a call from the sheriff, so I'm very happy about that. And Brother Scott fills in for Mark when he's gone. Thank you, Scott. Do a wonderful, wonderful job. And we welcome every one of you. Tonight is a very special night. 6 o'clock tonight, our children will present a program. Don't miss that. After that, Pastor will preach. But you come tonight, support these children. Our workers have worked a long, hard time with them, and they'll have a wonderful, beautiful program tonight. Don't miss it. Then Tuesday night, 7:30, here in our sanctuary, Kilgore College singers will present their annual program. We're honored that they would come out, and you're welcome to come 7:30 Tuesday night. It'll be a wonderful time. And we will show off our building, and they'll get to use it. And we are community people, and we're proud to support them. Now, at this time, we have something very, very special. You know, from time to time, people want to dedicate their babies. And when these little ones come, we're so thrilled. We have two families today, the May family and the Stevens family. New little ones, so we'll ask these two families to come forward, please, at this time and stand right by my side. You'll make me look better, I guarantee you.
All right. I've got to put my glasses on. I know better than to make an error on this. All right, and right here by my side, we have Mr. Mason Gregory May. And you have a picture of him, by the way, in your bulletin. Parents, Greg and Megan May. Sister, Kaylee. grandparents are Richard and Sandy May, Greg and Sandra Knight. And so what a lovely family, the May family. And I've spent time with these people, and I love them, and they have a beautiful home. They have a good business, and we're glad that they're with us. And then to my far left, and that baby is smiling already, we have Ellie Blake Stevens, born December the 18th, 2017. Parents, Jessica Jeff Stevens. Sisters, Sadie, Paisley, and Macy. Grandparents, Larry and Cindy Stevens, Chris, Lisa Thompson, Don, and Lori Couples. All the grandparents stand up too, of both parents if you're here. We welcome all here, back here. And what a beautiful, beautiful sight to have parents to bring their children to be dedicated to Christ. Jesus Christ said in the book of Matthew, "Let the children come to me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." Let the children come. How do we bring our children to Christ? Well, of course, in the arms of prayer. And these are praying people. The arms of prayer. The force of example. When these children see mama and daddy come to church, read the Bible and pray, there's a beautiful example that they're setting. And then, of course, just the love of God. They are expressing their love to God by being here today and worshiping God. And that's how we bring our children, the main reasons. There are other ways, of course. But thank God for you. And if we may, I'm going to stand here and put my little hands on this little fine baby and upon this baby and say a little prayer. Father, thank you for these beautiful children. All of them, all these parents, grandparents, everyone in this auditorium. And humbly I pray the blessings of God on these children. May mother and daddy continue to bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of God. And when they reach that age of accountability, we know they'll come to Jesus. Bless their lives. Thank you for them. Thank you for this occasion. And its dedication of these children unto thee. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. We just love to do things like that. All right, now, Macy, you be a good girl back there. We love these kids. All right, we have another young man that we love. I won't call him a kid, but he's got a beard and he's doing a great job for us. And his name is Matthew, and he'll tell you his last.
Well, I guess I have to say my name is Matthew Korzaneski, but it is a good day to be in the Lord's house, and a few things I want to make a mention of. Tonight at 5 o'clock, we are continuing our Revelation study church-wide in the gym with Brother Pippin, and then students, we will be in the Student Center continuing our study. A few other things I want to make sure you know about church-wide that are coming up. On this coming Saturday, we're having a church-wide work day. Brother Pat has that scheduled from 8 o'clock, as you see on the screen, till question mark. So y'all come on out and come serve with us. And then our senior adults, we are having our senior adult banquet on May 8th. And you can purchase tickets up till the 6th. So I just want to make sure y'all know that, that's coming up. And then I have two students that are going to come up here and make a real short announcement for y'all.
Good morning. On behalf of the youth group, Mary Catherine and I would like to invite all of the senior adults to the senior adult breakfast next Sunday, May 6th, and it's at the parlor at 9 o'clock. Thank you.
Let's continue singing hymn 502, the first and the last.
is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him.
Hymn 374 will be our offertory hymn. We'll sing both verses.
Since I started for the kingdom, since my life he controls, since I gave my heart to Jesus, longer I serve him, sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows, the more that I love him, love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him.
Please stand as we sing the last.
Thank you so much, and we come now to receive our Lord's offering. And you remember that giving is one way that we express our faith in Jesus Christ. It is a form of worship, and we are instructed in the Bible to bring our tithes and offerings. And so we give you that opportunity to give today, and we'll have our prayer, please.
And let's pray. Heavenly Father, good morning. We want to thank you again for another Lord's Day. We thank you for the opportunity that we could come to your house where we can learn and worship you. Father, we pray that you be with the group that is out in Missouri. We pray that you give them safety as they travel. We pray that you be with the offering that we're about to receive. I pray that you take it and you multiply it to meet the needs of the church. Father, we love you and we thank you so much for what you're going to do for us and everything that you're going to continue to do for us. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea. By faith alone, sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered, the anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging sea. The anchor holds. In spite of the storm, I've had visions, and I've had dreams. I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they would slip right through, like they were only grains of sand. And the anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas, but the anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have been young, and I'm older now, and there has been beauty these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life, oh, that's when God proved his love to me. And the anchor holds, though this ship's been battered, the anchor holds, though its sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas, but the anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas, the anchor holds in spite of the storm.
Thank you, Babs. What a wonderful song. And I love Babs. She knows what she's singing about. You know, all of us go through stormy weather. I never will forget, we had the great Angel Martinez scheduled to come here to bring us a revival meeting, and he called and he was ill. Before he passed, I was talking to him and he said, Duggins, the Sunday School Board of the Southern Baptist Convention asked me to write a commentary on the book of Job. He said, I have the title. I said, well, what is it, Angel? He says, stormy weather. He said, I'm in a storm. And God bless us. We all go through stormy weather, but the anchor holds. You know who that anchor is? That anchor is Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. And what a beautiful day to have these children dedicated. As I prayed this week, I wanted to bring a message about Jesus and the church. Jesus and the church. The church is very, very important. You and I live in a day when the church is being despised. The church is being done away with in many places. I forgot what they said. They're closing like 10 churches a day across America. It's an amazing thing. But I want to tell you, America needs the Christ of the church. And I love the church. And the Bible says, Jesus Christ speaking, that Jesus said these words, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will build my church. Jesus Christ is the head of the church, and he is the builder of the church. And I thank God for that. And there's another verse of scripture that says, and Jesus also loved the church and gave himself for it. Now, if you open your Bible, please, to the book of Acts, I want to show you a few things this morning about the church. The book of Acts is the history book of the church. If you want to know about the history of the church, you study the book of Acts. And someone well said, the book of Acts speaks of the acts of the Holy Spirit in and through the lives of the disciples, and how accurate that is. In the book of Acts, there are some things that are emphasized, and I want to emphasize those today. First of all, let me talk about the members of the church. Church membership is very, very important. And then we'll talk not only about the members of the church, but something else that's very important, and that is the message of the church. Time permitting, we'll say a word about the method of that early church. It had some members. The Bible said in Acts 1:8, if I remember correctly, that they all continued in one accord. You know what that means? Listen to me very, very carefully now. The church that Jesus Christ building is a group of people that are in unison and in fellowship and are working together. You would be surprised at the telephone calls I get and the questions that are asked me about how in the world have you maintained a staff at your church. You may not realize it, you may not know it, but I want to tell you something. The fact that Brother Mark has been here over 25 years now, Brother Pat about 150, and I've been here nearly 29, that's an amazing thing. We had a call from the Southern Baptist Convention. They asked me, how do you maintain a staff? And I said, well, we love each other. And I don't know a better answer to that. There's a unity of spirit here. We know what we're here for. And the church members in that early day were people that absolutely had fellowship one with another. They were unified. I well remember being in a revival meeting in Springfield, I believe it was called, Utah, about 100 miles south of Salt Lake City. Can you imagine going out there to hold a revival? Well, I go out there to hold a revival meeting. I'll never forget it as long as I live. It was, the pastor was sponsored by the Home Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention, little church building out there in that great Mormon country, and about 30 people came. They came some as far as one way, 50 miles going to church, 50 miles church, 50 miles home. We were the only evangelistic church in that area, and so anybody that was saved, they just came to church there. And we had some strange things that happened. I had a guy invite me to the home for a meal, and the pastor said that he's an Indian. He's been converted by the testimony of his wife. We went out to eat. They had one of these mud huts that you perhaps see on television, and I was just amazed how they lived out there. And they cooked in a little mud oven, and they had a delicious meal. I was afraid to ask what it was, but I ate it. God gave me a watch band he'd made, silver and turquoise. I still have that. And the pastor said, and this guy mumbled out something. He said, "I love this preacher. He preaches the truth without a forked tongue." And I thought, that's pretty good, Brother Scott. But one thing I remember, listen to me, about the fellowship of believers. That's my little theme now. We get along. One day a fella came to me and said, "Brother Duggins, my wife is dying in the hospital. Would you go with me to visit her?" And I said, "I certainly will." So we made our way to that little hospital in that little town. Walked in the room, and there was a lady over there, and she was just hours from death. And I walked to her bedside, and her husband said to her, as he woke her up and he called her name, I believe it was Alma, and said, "Alma, Alma, we have a brother from Texas to come to pray for you." And I thought about that a long time, a brother from Texas. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. And we have family members everywhere. And we must remember that if our church is to be the kind of church God wants us to be, we will be in fellowship one with another. I don't want to fight with any deacon or any group in the church. I want to be in fellowship. Can I have an amen? As far as I know, we are in fellowship one with another. And then that early church, I'll tell you something else about it. And they all continued in one accord, that's the fellowship, and prayer. Early church members depended upon prayer. Now, prayer is a great privilege that we have. Prayer is not an invention by man. Prayer is man's response to God's invitation to come boldly to the throne of grace. Isn't that wonderful? Oh, listen, let me give testimony about prayer. God answers prayer. B.B. Murphy is right here. B.B., I love you. B.B. had a grandfather whose name was B.B. Krim. And B.B. Krim, back in, I suppose, the 30s and 40s, was one of the most popular preachers in Texas. And he was known, telling the truth, as a fighting preacher. B.B. Krim was a big, tall, 6'4". And he loved to go into a town and hold a revival meeting. And he would find the roughest guy in town and go witness to him, usually end up in a fight with him. But the guy would eventually come to church and get saved. He knew what he was doing, but he was known as a fighting preacher. And he preached at Baylor University one time. And he talked about prayer. And he said, "You must be careful about what you pray for God answers prayer." He said, "All my life I've been a fighting preacher. And I pray, God, help me to be sweeter. God, help me to be sweeter. And he said, God answered that prayer. I now have sugar diabetes. And I like that story. I was in my office in Winsboro, Texas one time when I was pastor of First Baptist Church. And a man by the name of Larry Sparks came into my office. And his face was about that long. And I said, Larry, what's wrong with you? He said, Brother Duggan, do you know that I have a little company out here that we build oil-filled roads and we build, I forgot what you call them, for the units to set on and all. And it's dirt work, you know, and build sites. And he said, I've got about 30 men working for me and we don't have any work. He said, we haven't had any work. This was in the 80s now, back when they had a little bust. He said, we just don't have work, and all of these men have families, and I have used all my capital. He said, I've had these guys out mowing yard and painting my house and cleaning the flower beds. He said, just to keep them busy, they're working men, and we need some work. He said, Brother Duggins, I have a bid on 3 jobs. If one of those jobs come through, we'll work for 6 months. And he said, oh, listen, I want you to pray. And we got on our knees in my office, and man, we both prayed. You never heard such praying. And he went on his way, and about maybe 45 minutes or an hour, my phone rang. It was Larry Sparks, and he was just giggling and happy. He said, Brother Duggins, you must have a direct line. I said, what are you talking about, Larry? He said, when I drove back to my office, my wife was standing there with a phone in her hand and said, Larry, Larry, it's Exxon. And he had job number one. He said, oh, we were literally dancing in the office, and the phone rang again. He said, I got job number two. And he said, we were elated, and all of a sudden the phone rang again. I had job number three. He said, I've got to hire about 20 men. God answers prayer. The Bible says, call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things that thou knowest. Now, God does answer prayer. One time, you know, Mark and I love to do revival meetings together. We've done, he said 150. I think he's ministerially speaking, but we've done a lot of them together. And we didn't have any revivals one spring. And so I was at my house, and I got to thinking about that. I called Mark. I said, Mark, we got any revivals lined up? He said, not a one. I put the phone down, got literally on my knees, began to pray. I got up and was reading the Bible, getting ready for Sunday. The phone rang, and all of a sudden we began to have revivals. I think we did 3 that spring. You saying you're a great prayer? No, I'm not a great prayer. I need to pray more, but I will tell you one thing. When you study about prayer in the Bible, and you'll find over 500 references to it, there are 2 main things about prayer. Earnestness, pray from your heart. It's not head praying that gets through. It's when you call out to God from your heart in all earnestness. And I know about that. And then persistency. You know, Jesus said, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened. When he literally prayed it, the Greek text said, ask and keep on asking. Seek and keep on seeking. Knock and keep on knocking. And I cannot tell you all the reasons why that we are to be persistent. I can tell you sometimes when we're praying and praying and praying, it's just not on God's timetable yet. But the timetable does come, and God answers that prayer. Excuse me. It may be that there is something that God wants to give us better than what we're praying for. And the time comes when he does that. But I do know this, that God is a prayer answering God. Hallelujah. And there may be something in your life that you're praying about. I'm praying for my wife's health. I really am. I pray earnestly. I stay up some nights praying all night long about it. And hopefully we're going to make some progress. God answers prayer. And I want you to pray for our church that we'll reach more and more and more for Jesus Christ. My heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel, Paul said, is that they might be saved. And how can we go through life and not pray for the people of Kilgore and East Texas area? Oh, God, we need to have people saved. And I need to do my part. I need to pray, and I need to knock doors. I need to do all of that. The early church members had fellowship. They worked together. They prayed together. There's such a wonderful thing as corporate prayer and private prayer. We to go in our prayer closet and pray. And then they were obedient to our Lord. Remember the great testimony of Peter after he had been beaten with many stripes? And they told him, you're not to name the name of Jesus anymore. Preach in the name of Jesus. And he said, listen, I've got to do it. I've got to, whether it be right or wrong, I don't know, but I must tell about Jesus. My dear friends, he was obedient to our Lord. We must obey our Lord. Do you know that obedience is a sign of your faith? Trust and obey, the little song says. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. And I want to tell you, God wants us to be happy. God is a God of joy and happiness and humor. He made some of you guys. God, I wouldn't call any names. God is not a subtractor in life. He is a one that multiplies and adds to and gives us joy. Jesus said before he died, my joy I give unto you. And no one had the joy of God like our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, listen, he wants you to have joy in your home. He wants you to have joy where you work. He wants you to have joy about what you do. And here's what the Bible says, the joy of the Lord is your strength. And you know, you can get up and go when you have the joy of God about you. There's just something about it that energizes us. And those early church members, fellowshipping, praying, obedient to our blessed Lord, and they were holy. They were holy. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart. No, God, that we might have revival across this nation of not only preachers, but deacons and their wives and the entire church having holiness in their lives. My friend, we've got to turn from S-I-N, sin, whatever it might be. Sometimes we have the idea that I'm just sinning a little bit. I can get by with it. You'll never get by with any sin. There's a payday coming, and you don't want that. And listen, God doesn't want to correct you. He doesn't want to discipline you. He wants you to live a holy life. How do you do that, preacher? I'll tell you exactly how you do it. You take this old book called the Bible, my dear friend, you read it and study it and ask God to give you grace to live what it says in here. This is our standard. You heard that story about old Babe Ruth when he was at the prime of his career. Had a famous umpire umpiring at the plate. And he said, strike three, you're out, to Babe Ruth. Babe Ruth looked at him and said, you tomato head. That's better than some words that he could have used. He said, there are 40,000 people here who know that was a ball, not a strike. That umpire looked at Babe Ruth and said, well, you may be right, but my opinion is the only one that matters. I like that story. I want to tell you something. This book is what matters. Can I have an amen? It is the Word of the Living God. Open this book and you'll read about Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you, those early church members had holiness in their lives. Now, let me tell you, before time gets away from me, I've said just a few things about the members, and I could give you more and more of that. But if you remember those and live out those, you're going to be all right. And then, one more I want to add. Listen, missionary, because this is missing in some areas. Our church is known as a missions-giving church and participation church. I like that. I want us to always have missions. in our budget, and we do an outstanding work in missions, giving. I read years ago of a very famous church who employed a famous painter to paint a picture of a dying church. And you know what he did? He painted the most beautiful edifice you've ever seen in your life, the steeple and the stained glass windows, and he did it all. And at the side of it, he had a little offering plate. It had missions on it and cobwebs on the plate. And the idea is, when you stop giving to missions, you begin to die as a church. And how true it is. Jesus Christ said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Amen. Go everywhere. Now, obviously, not all of us can go everywhere. We can support those who go on our behalf and give the great message of Jesus Christ. We can go locally. We can go to our neighbor. We can go to our friends. We can take our stand living right for God and be missionaries where we are. Members. Now, look, please, at the message. What is the message of the church? Well, people are mixed up about it today. But I'm not mixed up about it. And I want to tell you, the Word of God is not mixed up. What is the message of the church? Jesus saves. Mark it down. Mark it down. There is none other name. There is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And that name is the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus came down from heaven to earth. He was born of the Virgin in Bethlehem. If your Bible doesn't have that and teach that, you get another Bible. He was born of a virgin. A virgin gave birth to the Son of God, and he lived a sinless life. He was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist, and when he went down under the water and coming up, the voice of God said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. He went into the wilderness and was tempted by Satan for 40 days and nights, and he rebuked him by the Word of God, not any other supernatural power other than the supernatural power of the Word of God. If you're not having victory over the devil today, get back to the Word. The Word will keep you from the devil, and the devil will keep you from the Word. Get back to the Word. He lived a life without sin, and one day he was crucified out on Mount Calvary. He said, blood for you and for me. They put him in a borrowed tomb, but on the third day, up from the grave he arose, and he lives today to save sinners. I'm not smart enough to preach any other message, but I am too smart to preach any other message than Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is needed by the church. Jesus Christ is needed by the lost man. Jesus Christ is needed in all circumstances, in all area. The sweetest name I know, the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one that says, come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. I've done that. My heart has bled sometimes, and I've gone to him, and I have found sweet rest for my soul. He's a gun that comforts us when we're disturbed, when our hearts are heavy. He gives us comfort. He's the one that strengthens us. I can do all things through Christ who pours his strength into my body. I know that to be a fact. I know it. It's happened to me. It can happen to you. God is no respecter of persons in that he chooses to bless one and not another. Listen, God loves every one of us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Can I tell you one more time? The saving message is the message of Jesus Christ. Now here's the question. Have you been saved today? Have you opened your heart to him? What must I do to be saved? Is asked only one time in this book of books. And the answer came back clear as crystal. Believe on the Lord Jesus, thou shalt be saved. I take that to be true. I know it to be true. When I was a boy, I believed. I couldn't pronounce the name of Moses. Barely can today. Doesn't matter. I know one thing. Jesus said, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise came cast out. And by the grace of God, I came to the great Savior. And oh my goodness, what a life, what a life. To God be the glory, great things he's done. I'm nothing but Jesus is everything. And what he's done for me, he'll do for you. He'll help you, he'll guide you. He is our great shepherd that leads us. Come to Jesus. Come as you are to Jesus, as he is. He stands today loving you, outstretched arms saying, come, I want to help you. I'll heal your hurting heart. I'll forgive every sin. I'll give you direction. You can know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Come to Jesus. Oh, what a Savior we have today. Come to Christ. Some need to come to be saved. Some need to come just to get back. The message is a bit about the church. Some of us have neglected our church. We need to come back and say, I want to rededicate myself, because the church is God's institution. I will build my church. Yes, he is his. The church is his. Remember the verse? Christ loved the church, gave himself for it. I want to love my church. I want to give my life for Jesus Christ, just like he gave for the church. Would you bow with me, please?